Lesson three, the dangers of silence, the consequences of indifference, the duty, the responsibility to protect. In a word, the genocide of European Jewry succeeded not only because of the industry of death and because of the state-sanctioned ideology of hate, as I mentioned, but because of crimes of indifference, because of conspiracies of silence. We are assembled here on the banks of Lake Geneva, on the other side of which lies Evian des Bains. It was here in 1938 that the international community considered the plight of hundreds of thousands of Jewish refugees desperate to flee worsening prosecution in Nazi Germany and Austria. But the nations of the time looked away. As it was said then, the world was divided into places where the Jews could not live and the places where they could not enter. Hitler drew the lessons. And indeed, we have witnessed an appalling indifference and action in our own day, which took us down the road to the unthinkable ethnic cleansing in the Balkans and the unspeakable, the genocide in Rwanda. I say unspeakable because this genocide was preventable. Nobody could say that we did not know. We knew, but we did not act. Just as we know, and we are not acting in the genocide by attrition in Darfur, ignoring the lessons of history, betraying the people of Darfur, and mocking the important responsibility to protect doctrine as affirmed by the United Nations itself. And so it is our responsibility, and I say this particularly for the successor generations, to break down these walls of indifference, to shatter these conspiracies of silence, to stand up and be counted, and not look around to see whoever else is standing before we make a judgment to do so. Because in the world in which we live, there are few enough people prepared to stand, let alone to be counted, reminding us of the words of Edmund Burke, that the surest way to ensure that evil will triumph in the world is for enough good people to do nothing. Indifference and inaction always mean coming down on the side of the victimizer, never on the side of the victim. Let there be no mistake about it. Indifference in the face of evil is acquiescence with evil itself. It is complicity with evil. Lesson four, combating mass atrocity and the culture of impunity, the responsibility to bring war criminals to justice. If the 20th century, symbolized by the Holocaust, was the age of atrocity, it was also the age of impunity. Few of the perpetrators were brought to justice. And so, just as there must be no sanctuary for hate, no refuge for bigotry, so there must be no base or sanctuary for these enemies of humankind. In this context, the establishment of the International Criminal Court must be seen as the most dramatic development in international criminal law since Nuremberg, to deter mass atrocity, to protect the victims, and to prosecute the perpetrators. Lesson five, the trahison d'éclair, the responsibility to talk truth to power. The Holocaust was made possible not only because of the bureaucratization of genocide, as Robert Lifton put it, but because of the trahison d'éclair, the complicity of the elites, physicians, church leaders, judges, lawyers, engineers, architects, educators, and the like. Indeed, one has to only read Gerhard Müller's book on Hitler's justice to see and read of the complicity and criminality of judges and lawyers, or to read Robert Jan van Pelt's book on the architecture of Auschwitz, to be appalled by the minute involvement of engineers and architects in the design of the death camps and so on. Holocaust crimes, therefore, were the crimes of the Nuremberg elites. As Elie Wiesel put it, cold-blooded murder and culture did not exclude each other. If the Holocaust proved anything, it is that a person can both love poems and kill children. And so it is our responsibility to speak truth to power and to hold power accountable to truth. And those entrusted with the education and training of the elites should ensure that Elie Wiesel is studied in the schools of law, not just in classes of literature, that the double entendre of Nuremberg is part of our learning as it is part of our legacy, that Holocaust education underpin our perspective as it informs our principles on justice and justice. And so, lesson six, the responsibility to educate. In particular, the spirit of this International Day of Commemoration, in memory of the victims of the Holocaust, in this spirit, states should commit themselves to the constituent elements of the Declaration of the Stockholm International Forum on the Holocaust, which included the pledge, and I quote, to strengthen efforts to promote education, remembrance, and research about the Holocaust. A commitment, as the Stockholm Declaration put it, to remember the victims who perished, respect the survivors still with us, and reaffirm humanity's common aspiration for mutual understanding and justice, which brings me to the last lesson. The vulnerability of the powerless, the protection of the vulnerable as the test of a just society. The genocide of European Jewry occurred again not only because of the vulnerability of the powerless, but also because of the powerlessness of the vulnerable. It is not surprising that the triage of Nazi racial hygiene, the sterilization laws, the Nuremberg race laws, the euthanasia program, targeted those, and I quote, whose lives were not worth living. And it is not unrevealing, as Professor Henry Friedlander points out in his work on the origins of genocide, that the first group targeted for killing were the Jewish disabled. And so it is our responsibility as government representatives, as citoyens du monde, to give voice to the voiceless as we empower the powerless, be they the disabled, the poor, the refugee, the elderly, the women victims of violence, the vulnerable child, the most vulnerable of the vulnerable. May I close now with a word to the survivors of the Holocaust themselves. For you, and Ms. Vaillant is with us, for you are the true heroes of humanity. You witnessed and endured the worst of inhumanity, but somehow you found in the depths of your own humanity the courage to go on, to rebuild your lives as you helped build your communities. And so it is with you, and because of the righteous among the nations like Raoul Wallenberg, that we remember that each person has a name and an identity, that each person is a universe, that in saving one life we save an entire universe. We remember and we pledge that never again will we be indifferent to incitement and hate, that never again will we be silent in the face of evil, that never again will we indulge racism and anti-Semitism, that never again will we ignore the plight of the vulnerable, that never again will we be indifferent in the face of mass atrocity and impunity. We will speak and we will act against racism, against hate, against anti-Semitism, against mass atrocity, against injustice, and against the crime of crimes whose name we should even shudder to mention, genocide. And yes, always, always against indifference, against being bystanders to injustice. For in what we say, or more importantly, in what we do, we make a statement about ourselves as a people. We make a statement about ourselves as people. For in our day, more than ever, qui s'excuse s'accuse. Whoever remains indifferent indicts themselves. May this day be not only a day and act of remembrance, which it is, but let it be a remembrance to act on behalf of humanity and against inhumanity, as it must be. Thank you.